OBJECTified, Steven Tyler.
These are the original working lyrics for
Toys in the Attic. Oh my God, may I? This is fantastic. I'm Harvey Levin. This is a story about a man whose name became synonymous with rock and roll. Steven Tyler became one of the biggest names in music and enjoyed every perk that went along for the ride. As a rock star, how easy is it to get laid?
It's very easy. I think rock stars, I felt like I had an obligation to keep that alive, and women had their way with me.
An obligation to keep it alive?
Oh, yeah.
But his journey to the top was no match for his own personal demons.
I have an addictive personality, so I found certain drugs that I loved, and I didn't stop to the point of hurting my children, hurting my family, hurting my life. It was a point where I didn't have a band, and I didn't care.
But Steven fought hard to get clean and clawed his way back to the top again, this time bigger than ever.
There isn't a day that I wake up that I'm not moved to tears, that I think how lucky I am to be in this band. This is phenomenal.
Steven Tyler, the rock star who personifies every stereotype, living the sex, drugs, and rock and roll lifestyle, and actually living to tell about it.
Hey, Steven.
Harvey, how be you?
So good to see you.
Good to see you, too.
Oh, well, good to see you.
Welcome to the digs of all digs.
I love these digs. I gotta tell you, Steven, you have such a rich life. I wanna learn your life story through objects that you chose to keep over the years that are really important to you. Okay?
Yeah.
You wanna get started?
I would love to get started.
Let's do it.
My mom and dad passed away while I was doing Idol. So I got their wedding rings, and I got my mom's wedding ring and my dad's wedding ring.
That's so cool.
And I wore it every day in the middle of my crow feather. I mean, they're in me, you know what I'm saying? To have their ring, what they wore, you know, every day, to me, artifacts, I live for that. I'm like a hoarder.
Okay, everybody knows Steven Tyler, right?
Yeah, all right.
I want to hear about Stevie Tallarico.
Little Stevie Tallarico was born up under the piano. My father was from Juilliard.
Well, that's the thing. Your dad was from Juilliard. He played Carnegie Hall?
Classical piano, played Carnegie Hall, yeah.
And your grandfather was a cellist?
He's a cellist. And there was a grand piano upstairs in the living room. And I was put under the piano to fall asleep every night.
Hmm.
So I heard Bach, Brahms, Beethoven, Debussy.
You got relatives who are classical musicians.
Mm.
Why didn't you follow suit? Why did you make a left?
Well, my father tried to give me piano lessons, and I sat at the piano, and I started yawning. And when you're Italian from family, it's like, whack. You got whacked.
What were you into?
The drums. My friend down the street had a set of drums, Slingerland drums. I couldn't believe there were such things built that you banged with sticks and made noise. So my father bought me a set of drums, and I wound up playing drums in his band in the summertime. So it just turned into that music. And I got the blessings of my mom and dad to do rock and roll. They knew I could sing. I went to choir when I was a little boy, and Joe Perry just left L.A.
Hey, Joe.
Hey, Joe! All right, so.
He left you again.
Okay, he's hanging out with Johnny Depp.
What music, what artists influenced you?
I gotta say, the Everly Brothers, because of their harmony. It's the first time I ever felt any kind of sexual feelings from the waist down. Their harmonies together, the Everly Brothers, in their harmony lived something I couldn't explain, I didn't understand, but it felt like, it didn't feel like sex, it felt like something so wonderful that I'd never heard.
I want to talk a little bit about your upbringing. You hunted, shotguns,
mm-hmm.
You were hanging out in the woods. You just don't strike me as a country boy.
I still carry a knife everywhere I go.
Why?
It's dope in my fan mail. You know, I don't know why. I
mean, but you were mostly...
I had a knife made, and I actually got to share this with you. It's ridiculous. It's so beautiful. And it's such a
piece... You really
piece,
do carry the
knife. It's such a... Well, along with that one and this one.
Oh, my God.
But it's such a piece of art that, you know, it's got a blade, and it flicks out like that. And, you know, that's what you do when you're showing your friends. But if you get in trouble...
Oh, my God, I feel like I'm somebody in the militia. What?
No, it's just... I'm just showing you... how I grew up in the woods.
I get it. So when did you discover girls?
Wow. My uncle had an incredible Playboy collection. So it was that kind of thing. And I guess 1956, 57.
So you were about 9?
Yeah.
When did you discover drugs?
Wow. When I first heard music. Our era, yours and mine, and I don't know whether you admit it on TV or not, but you did some drugs in your time.
You're wrong.
Hello?
No, you're wrong.
Bull.
I was totally frightened.
You never smoked a joint in your life?
No, I did smoke a joint, but I took but I took a towel, a wet towel, put it under the door to make sure nobody would come in and arrest me, and that's as much as I did. I was just a paranoid Jew.
Okay, and I was a paranoid Italian. I took, you know how a door, when you open a door, you know, that thing goes in a door? I drilled through, when you turn the doorknob, I drilled through it and I stuck a nail in there. Yeah. So no one could come into the bedroom. Because if you got caught with a joint, you knew you were going to hell.
Did your parents drink?
Yeah.
A lot?
Yeah, they did. My family drank.
I'm curious about being bullied. Did you kind of drink and smoke just to kind of detach?
You could probably say I wanted to be liked. I wanted people to notice me as a teenager. And you know how cruel kids are. The whole school was making fun of my lips, you know. I was called the N-word lips. I was called lips in school. And I was beaten up. I was beaten up bad.
You got thrown out of high school because of what happened in ceramic class. That was for pot,
smoking pot, yeah, you know.
You got prosecuted for that.
No, I didn't get prosecuted.
I thought
the charges were dropped. You know, the best news? I got a YO, youthful offender. So it kept me out of the draft.
Oh, God.
Thank you, God.
Wait a minute. Are these the...
These are the original working lyrics for...
Oh, my
Toys
God. May I?
Yeah, you may.
This is so fantastic. And this is what you wrote on?
Yup. I wrote on that. No more, no more, around and around, you see me crying.
Why'd you want to become a rock star?
I saw Janis Joplin when I was 15, and I heard her sing, and I couldn't believe she was smoking on stage. She was drinking Southern Comfort, and she sang like no other. She could sing a song entitled, Take a Little Piece of My Heart, and deliver it so beautifully.
Amazingly.
Amazingly.
I think there's something that attracts people to this. I mean, is it the adulation from a crowd? Is it that you can make a ton of money? Is it just rampant sex, which everybody hears about?
How'd you get a job?
Oh, that's one reason. My girlfriend's going, you had to get a job.
Well, it's got to be something more than that.
It's all I knew how to do, you know. I didn't get it. I didn't know anything but music and mother and nature.
You weren't immediately successful. You were in some bands that went nowhere.
Well, all the bands from 66 to 69, it was over. I quit a band. I was out on Long Island.
Did you ever give up?
I got into a fight with a guitar player, jumped over my drum set. I was a drummer at the time. Got into a fight with him. I got so pissed off, I went outside and went like this. And back then, you could hitch. I hitched all the way from Southampton to New York City, from New York City all the way to Sunapee, New Hampshire. So I got up there, went to bed crying, woke up the next morning, mowed the lawn like I had for all my life, and up comes Joe Perry in an MG. Joe Perry. Horn-rimmed glasses with white hair. Said, hey, man, what are you doing up here? I said, I broke up. All my bands are over. He goes, well, you want to come see mine? I'm in a band called the Jam Band, and we're playing tonight. I'll come pick you up, and we're playing. And I went, yeah. So I went and sat down, saw them, and they did one song that was so good. It was a song called Rattlesnake Shake. And when they did that, I went, that's it. If I can add what I know to him, this is my brother now, Joe. Now I got my brother. Now I got my Keith Richards. I got my Paul and John. I got the Kinks. So we decided to move to Boston, get an apartment together. And we would start playing songs, right? We'd play clubs, 4 45-minute sets a night. Regardless whether anyone was there, my understanding back then that I said, we can get laid together, We can do drugs together. We can have girlfriends and together. We can go to movies together. We can live in a house together. We can write songs together. Ah, we can write songs together. And maybe we can have a chance to make it big. Those were the words. I'd love to tell you, I always knew I'd make it. You don't know until you write that first song. When I wrote that first song with Joe Perry, that's when it game over.
Didn't like your voice for a time.
Well, don't. I was just going to sing a song, and you were going to join in. You said, nah, you don't want to hear me.
Because I'm not going to sing with Steven Tyler.
Let's dump it back on you. Why not?
Because I
don't like your voice.
No, actually, I like my voice. Nobody else does.
Oh, he's good. This guy is good. And maybe I could say that about mine. I like my voice. But I thought, no, I didn't like my voice. I didn't like it, and so I sang the whole first album like this, get yourself a cooler and lay yourself low. I sang like that, just.
Okay, so I want to talk to you about LSD.
Hmm.
Not the drug.
Oh, please, bring it on.
Lead singer disorder.
Bring it on.
Explain it.
Well, lead singer disorder is something that other band members like to lay on a singer because he's getting laid more than they are.
That is succinct. So it's all about sex?
It can be sex, drugs, and rock and roll. It's not about not sex. Music is about sex.
So there was jealousy in the band?
Oh, there's jealousy in every band.
Is that what created a lot of the tension? Because there was a lot of tension in Aerosmith.
If you're gonna play a title like this, then let's do it.
But you didn't say that before, man. You said you wanted it just like that.
Yeah, I started
to play it like that, and you said, no, I don't want to lock into it like that. So I said, well, then use the machine. How much plainer can that be? I'm not trying to give you a hard time.
A lot of the still is right now.
Did drugs make you better as a singer, as a writer?
It certainly got me over hurdles, and it certainly, the songs you know and love, that Joe and I wrote very high.
Would you be successful as the lead singer of Aerosmith? Would Aerosmith be successful without drugs?
By 71 to 79, we played every state in America 7 times. We couldn't have done it without that Peruvian marching powder, methamphetamine. We just played and played and played, and those guys were so good. I love them forever, and just think that I get to be in this band. There isn't a day that I wake up that I'm not moved to tears, that I think how lucky I am to be in this band. This is phenomenal.
How do you have a meaningful relationship when you have women throwing themselves at you all the time?
You cheat. You cheat. You break. You're not true. You're not faithful.
Yes, 9 o'clock works for me. Bye. Another referral. Our customers love us.
When the unexpected strikes,
don't worry, we've got you covered.
The heart.